Shravanam, Mananam, Nidhityasanam. Listen, reflect and absorb. Dear listeners, Sai Ram and welcome to our radio series in which a divine discourse by Bhagwan is played in small parts and following each part a short discussion is undertaken to reflect on the message. This is a part of Radio Sai's Thursday Live hosted by Sai Prakash and Prem every Thursday at 7:30 p.m. only on Asia Stream of Radio Sai Global Harmony. In today's episode, which was first broadcast live on 21st November 2013, Professor G. Venkatraman, former Vice Chancellor of the Sri Satya Sai Institute of Higher Learning and the senior-most member of Team Radio Sai, participated as a guest. The discourses undertaken for study in this program are from the series of discourses delivered as part of the summer course in Indian culture and spirituality in the year 1990.
Offering our most humble pranams at Bhagwan's lotus feet. Dear listeners, this is Prem from Team Radio Sai, being joined by Sai Prakash as always to host this segment of Shravanam, Mananam, Nididhyasanam. And as we promised you last week, we are here with a comprehensive summary, or so we hope, of the first 8 discourses. We would like to take them in parts, and as we made another promise last week, we also have the pleasure of the company of Professor Venkatraman. We're very grateful to him for having joined us on this program. So, without wasting more time, I invite Sai Prakash and Professor Venkatraman to join me in presenting this program. Sai Ram, Sai Prakash, and Sai Ram, and welcome to you, sir.
Sai Ram, Prem, thank you for the introduction. I think this is going to be a difficult task, trying to summarize the first 4 discourses. We have the easier task of just posing the questions. But the way we have structured it is, we thought we would bring out 1 or 2 points what Swami has mentioned, and based on that we would raise 1 or 2 questions, and then we'll go along. So as we have been doing in this series, this is a series of discourses given in 1990 summer course, and Swami is dealing with a very subtle and most important topic of who you really are. And Swami has taken it over a series of 16 discourses. And the first discourse very beautifully brings out the importance of truth and righteousness. Swami says that it's very important to know the truth and follow dharma. And then he goes on in the subsequent 2 discourses. He elaborates about the human body. And he says how one should understand why the body is gifted to you. What is the use of the human body? It's very strange, because when you think of the body being gifted to you, it automatically connotes that you are not the body. But let us go through the discourse and know how Swami actually brings out those points. Then in subsequent discourses, Swami has dealt with the senses, the mind, the intellect, and possibly the Atman later. But right now, since we have come halfway through the series, we thought it would be nice to take a break and then summarize and discuss some of the important points that Swami has brought out in these discourses. So Prem, I think we'll start with summarizing the first discourse, and we can discuss the points as we go along. We are starting with the first discourse, where Swami is talking about Satya and Dharma. You know, there is one very famous, very beautiful padyam which Swami would start with in some of his other discourses. He says, Naham manushyo nacha deva yakshaha, na brahmana kshatriya vaishya shudraha, aham satya bodhakaha, satyam shivam sundaram. And Swami has always laid stress and given importance to truth, his name being Satya Sai. He said, I am the one who rests on truth. So Swami starts this discourse with a padyam, as always, in which he says the entire cosmos has emerged and shall go back into truth. And he then goes on to say that truth, according to Vedanta, is also referred to as Brahman. He says Brahman and truth. God is truth and truth is God. So with that, and then he says Satyam Shivam Sundaram. Now he says the Bharatiyas from a long time have given utmost important form. They have considered truth to be very vital. And he says Bharatiya culture has always given importance to understanding truth. And that's why we have Satyam Vada and Dharmam Chara. So starting with this concept of truth and dharma, Sir, we would just like to pose a question. And we were just wondering, when we are talking about this truth, what exactly is the truth that Swami is referring to here? What is the kind of truth that we should be tuned to? Is it the factual truth, or is there something more than that?
Sir, it's a good question. You said, what is the kind of truth? Actually, there are not many kinds of truth. There is only truth and nothing other than truth.
Correct.
And yet, truth, if we have to refer to it and discuss it, must have a context.
Correct.
A frame of reference. For most of us, the frame of reference is the world in which we live.
Yes.
But even in this world in which we live, there are many strange things that happen. A famous scientist, Erwin Schrodinger, raises this. And that is where I read it, and I'm sure it's there in Vedanta, but he has put it in his book, and when I read it, I really found it very interesting and compelling. And this is what he says. You are sleeping, you are having a dream. In the dream, you are there. You are one of the players in the dream.
Correct.
And there are other fellows also in the dream. And some of them are praising you, some of them are abusing you and all that. And you are trying to deal with those fellows, good guys and bad guys. He says, do you realize all those guys are really you? But yet in the dream, you feel you are separate from them. So we have a very strange situation. What I'm trying to say is, the context relating to the dream state is different from the context relating to the waking state. So straight away I have two states, and I have to struggle with what is truth in my dream. And what Swami is saying is, there is one more context which is fundamentally important, but which is always forgotten, at least in today's world, or more or less 99.999% of the time forgotten. What is that? For the seen, the unseen is the basis. That is an abstract way of seeing. And sometimes you would just use two words, Aadharam and Aadheyam. Aadheyam is what is seen, Aadharam is what is the basis. The basis may not be seen. The basis that he is referring to, and the basis which is not seen, but which is most important, is the divine. So he says, if you are talking of truth, unless it is related to the divine, you are talking of something else, or something which is a very tiny subset of it. Now, the moment I connect the truth to divine, what does it mean? It means it is eternal and unchanging. And, okay, it is eternal and changing, it is divine. But what has that got to do with me? Well, in everything that I do, the flavor of that which is eternal and unchanging must be reflected. Now, Gandhi described God, truth as follows. God and truth. God is truth, and truth must be manifested as ahimsa. Because ahimsa is also one of the attributes of Brahman, which is another synonym for truth. So, there are attributes associated with truth. One of which is dharma or righteous action, another of which is prema or selfless love, another of which is ahimsa or non-violence, another of which is shama or forbearance, daya, karuna, and so on and so forth. Therefore, when Swami is talking of truth and he says, be truthful, it means your thought, word, and deed must reflect the divine in terms of flavor, fragrance, and manifestation.
Very beautiful.
That's what it means. If you are thinking of something, let it be good. If you are saying something, let it be good. If you are doing something, let it be good. If all this happens, then you are true to yourself. You are being truthful. You are manifesting truth. That's what it means. But we are not talking about that most of the time. So the context becomes the unseen, the eternal. That's what it is. And normally we don't bring all that in relation to a world in which we live.
Correct.
Which is changing and all that. For me, truth is what is said in latest Facebook or Twitter or whatever it is. That's nonsense.
But in its relation to action in daily life, in a way that is what is defined as dharma. The truth in action when you have...
Absolutely. There's no question about it. It is often described. Dharma is satya in action. It's like, you know, the telescope. Dharma is inside. If you pull it out, it is visible. Otherwise, it's
beautiful.
Inside.
That's true. So, dharma is basically doing action, keeping that subtle truth in the back of your...
Absolutely.
So, that is the kind of truth and dharma that Bharatiyas were giving importance
Even
to.
That is not very clear, because if my action is to be truly called dharma, it must be selfless. It must be non-violent in every sense of the term. It must be full of love. It must exhibit forbearance, swartham, saprayojanam, should not be there. All these things are there. That is implied.
Correct.
That's why it's very, as Palkiwala said, dharma is a word which has no equivalent in foreign languages. You cannot translate it. Unless you know what is daya, karuna, prema, etc., you can't talk about dharma. Once you know that, if you say your action must be dharmic, that other guy will understand. So it needs a resonance.
In fact, what you just said is exactly what Swami also says in the next line. He says, dharma is not observance of any tradition or ritual. It is a unity of thought, word and deed, which results in purification of the faculties. So he says, the manifestation of truth in action is dharma.
And of course, the beautiful way Swami connects this with Indian culture, Swami says, the true Bharatiya is one who is wedded to truth and righteousness. And that is why Indian culture is important, Bharatiya culture is important, not Indian culture as we understand or we might pass it on today.
Actually, somebody was telling me, my brother-in-law was talking to me on the phone the other day. Somebody went to see the late Kanchi Paramacharya. And he said, don't call yourself Hindu. There is no such thing as Hindu. Say you are a follower of Sanatana Dharma. It is an endless righteousness. I follow that. That's all. That is Indian culture.
So, having given the importance, in fact, Swami goes on to say that there are people with a lot of power, and you may have military power, intellectual power, physical power, monetary power, political power, but you have to bow.
There are other things called soft power.
So, but he said truth and righteousness is inevitable and they will always triumph.
Only problem is sometimes they are very slow.
That's true. It maybe takes a few lifetimes at... the next statement that Swami is making is very interesting. He says the chief requisite of man's life is to be human. So, we have heard Swami bringing out this point in many of his discourses where he says the proper study of mankind is man. We would like to understand this concept a little bit more, sir.
They are slightly different because in one case, man and mankind come. Mankind is a reference to society.
Oh, okay.
So, if you want to understand society, how it should be, you must study the human body. That's what is the implication.
Oh, okay.
I'll explain that. But what when he says you must be human, it is something so obvious and yet not very obvious to people these days. What he's saying is, you should not behave like an animal. And that is why Pope Benedict said, now former Pope, to be called human, you must first show humanness. Don't show tigerness. Don't show frogness. Don't show crowness, donkeyness, monkeyness, and so on. That is the way. No, who is a true human? Who is an ideal human? That question is very interesting because Valmiki asked Narada the same question. Is there a person
correct
with the following qualifications, A, B, C, all those refer to a true human? Narada smiles and says, yes, there is such a person. He is Sri Ramachandra, the king of Ayodhya, emperor of Ayodhya. So, we think having a form of a human being is enough. In English, there are these famous statements. He is a wolf in sheep's clothing. What does that mean? That guy is really a wolf, but he's pretending to be a sheep and very this thing. Nice and gentle. So, today, we are having the human form, but we are hardly behaving like a human being should in the ideal sense of the word. So, that mistake and error is what Swami is pointing out there. You have the form, but you don't have the behavior that is appropriate to the form. He has also said this in many other ways. For example, in a drama, if you have the king's part, you should not behave like a joker. And I don't know whether you remember, there is a story of a great actor. He wears the role of a sannyasi and he acts very well. And that day king gives him sanmanam. He says, no, I'm a sannyasi. So, I can't take it. Okay. Because he's wearing the dress, he has not taken off the dress. Next day he comes as a dancer. And then the king says, very nice. And this guy is waiting. He says, what... He says, you have not given me any sanmanam. No, yesterday I gave. You didn't want it. That is different. Yesterday I was sannyasi. Sannyasi is not supposed to accept rewards. Today I am a dancer. I expect a reward. You have to give it. I don't know whether you know the story. He has told it a few times in the old days. So, you have to act the part you have been given by God. If you have been given the part of a human, act like a human, not like a monkey or a donkey. That's what he's trying to say.
In fact, Swami is making that point here when he says that there is no use to the world from people who are merely human in form.
No, yes,
he says they are dangerous.
Swami goes on. You're right, absolutely.
He says, whatever your scholarship or position or authority, you cannot ignore the human values. That's what Swami says. He says that...
If you do so, you do so at your risk. In fact, it has come to a stage where it is a risk to the whole of society. Now, this is where... The other question, proper study of mankind is man, becomes relevant. One day I asked him, I don't understand this. So we were alone. We had gone to the college. I was the vice chancellor. He talked about this. Came back and said, forgive me, Swami, I don't understand. Then he said, supposing a fellow is walking in the forest, a thorn goes into his foot. He's walking barefoot. Tribals do that. What will he do? Then that fellow will sit in a rock, hold the foot with one hand and pull out the thorn with the other hand. He said, that's right, but why should the hand come and pull out the thorn? It is that a leg is paining. What has the hand got to do with it? And I said, Mommy, it's part of the body and the body feels the pain. No. Hand has got this problem. What has it got to do? You have a stomach ache and the doctor gives an injection in the hand. The hand can say, go and give it to the stomach. Why are you giving it to me? Then he started saying things like this. You have fever and then you are asked to drink bitter medicine. Well, the tongue can say, yuck, and they spit it out. Doesn't do that. Why? Then he said, the body has got an operating system, to use modern language. The cell is the basic unit, and body is just a collection of cells. There are, of course, different kinds of cells. Brain cells are different from heart cells, which are different from blood cells, and so on. But cell is a cell. You put a lot of bricks, you get a body. And from cells come the organs. From organs come different systems. You have digestive system, respiratory system, lymphatic system, and so on. And they are all overlaying each other. The cell works for the organ, organ works for the system, system works for the body. All systems work in harmony. Now, if you look at society, the individual is the equivalent of the cell. There are many types of individuals, just as there are many types of cells. And ultimately, it is individuals who make society. And just as organs, you have functional units in society, you have bank, post office, school, police station, court, railway station, airport, and so on. Everywhere there are people working. Just as there are cells in the lung and the heart, there are people working in a bank, in a school, post office, railway station, so on. Here, all the cells work for the organ. There, all the fellows must work for the institution. If they work properly, the institution will be proper. I mean, you will get good service in the post office, bank, or whatever it is. And if all banks do that, the entire banking system will be good, the entire postal system will be good, the entire railway system will be good. It used to be said that when Mussolini was dictator in Italy, all trains were on time. Not even 1 minute late. So anyway, if you have a society in which everything is perfect, you have Ramarajya. But what is the key to this? The key is that everybody works without swartham and suprayojanam for that entity that is above. Cell works like that without swartham and suprayojanam for the organ. Organ works the same way for system. System works for the body. In the case of the body will take care of all these organs and cells. How? The person will eat the right food. He'll make sure there is iron so that the hemoglobin is okay. He'll make sure there is calcium so that bones are okay. He will make sure that there is this vitamin, that stuff, this stuff, and so on. This is a balanced diet. Then second thing is he will not overeat. Third thing is he will eat only at the right times, not all the time, munching and potato chips or drinking Coca-Cola and so on. Fourth thing, he will exercise. Fifth thing, he will take proper rest. Sixth thing, he will maintain regularity. Seventh thing, he will not allow stress. Because stress can damage the system. So, leading a disciplined life, the fellow makes sure that the body gets what it wants. In other words, if you work for a master, the master takes care of you. Same way in a society, if you work for society, society must take care of you. How? It must provide you all the securities you want. It must provide you food security, housing security, job security, health security, education security, and so on. That is Ramarajya. So, the essential requirement is the humans must work without swartham and swaprayojanam. If all the people work in the spirit of karma yoga, that society will run very smoothly. By and large. That is what happens in Japan. It is a remarkable place where karma yoga is in action all the time. Oh yes, there are a few glitches here and there at two extremes. The political system at the top is corrupt and there are some mafias, small amount. The drishti parikaram will always be there. But the average Japanese is extremely honest, extremely work conscious. And if you ask him to do X, he will do 2X. Whatever they take, they are like that. As a nation, I have not seen that kind of thing anywhere else. To some extent, it is there in Germany, but Japan is way ahead of others. That is the operating system. Swami says society must adopt, and you have to just copy a healthy body. Supposing in a body, the cells in a certain organ misbehave, then that organ will be sick. If the cells misbehave throughout the body, you have a case of metastasis, that is gone case. Person will die. Society does not die. It becomes dysfunctional and a failed society. You have example of that in Somalia. It's a failed society. There is no government. There is no what you call postal system. There is no education system. There is no national currency. There is no passport office. There are survival. People have their own communities and all that. They have, for namesake, a country called Somalia. But there is really no strong country called Somalia in the sense of having a federal bank, postal system, educational system, nothing. Just collapse for, it's like going on like that for 20 years. They're trying to revive it. Many other countries are on the threshold of becoming failed. And that is because many things have gone wrong. Even a rich country can come apart if it is overtaken by extreme selfishness. If everybody becomes selfish, it will take 5 minutes for it to break and collapse. Mm. So we can't take these things for granted. And today, with the power of technology, it is very easy to cause disruption on a very large scale.
Correct.
So we really have to pay very careful attention to Swami's words and advice and not treat it as unworkable, irrelevant for this society. That's one way of dismissing Swami's teachings. The more we become addicted to technology, more we need this. It's a desperate remedy and the best remedy.
It's very interesting, sir, what you say about Ramaraja, because generally we think Ramaraja means you have a ruler like Rama. But Ramaraja cannot be possible without the subjects who are equally dharmic. That point is often overlooked.
That is why it used to be said, Yata Raja Tata Praja. But now it has to be the other way. Yata Praja Tata
Because the government is by the people and for
because,
the people.
So-called. We have to change the government. That is why Swami was always talking about grassroots movements. He was not talking about I make a good man and he it will flow down. It is no longer a top-down approach. It's a bottom-up approach. It has to be that way. And people always ask, when will the golden age come? When you become golden, it will be the golden age. They don't like that answer, but that's the truth.
Very interestingly, that's exactly the next point Swami brings about in this discourse.
I didn't read the discourse.
that's where he says, science and technology coupled with industrialization is bringing about undesirable changes in our society by way of uprooting the moral or ethical values so essential for human well-being. Science and technology actually was developed, invented, and is being pursued for the betterment of human society. It's kind of contradictory how it is becoming the cause for degradation of society.
Actually, it is not correct to say science was developed for the betterment of society. Mm-hmm. Science is the result of knowledge accumulated out of the pursuit of curiosity.
Okay.
Basically, people were curious. Mm-hmm. Why doesn't the moon fall down? Okay. Mm-hmm. This is okay. I can't go to sleep unless I know the answer. And there's nothing wrong in thinking about those things. And a lot of people thought about a lot of those things. Mm-hmm. And they developed the fabric of science. At this stage, it is knowledge. Mm-hmm. Knowledge is neutral. It's neither good nor bad.
Correct.
It is what you do with knowledge that is good or bad. Who uses knowledge? People like you and me. When does it become good knowledge? When a good man uses it. Mm-hmm. When does it become bad knowledge? When a man with sorcerer's apprehension uses it. And he will use it, you know, at first for profit. Then in order to maintain that profit, he may use what you call cruel methods. Then he becomes a wicked man. And finally he becomes a rakshasa. So all that is misuse of knowledge. Mm. And that is the point that Ravana epitomized. He, as Swami used to say, knew 64 shastras. But he could chant the Vedas also. But he was afflicted with greed and karma. That was his problem. And that brought him down. So the problem is not with science. The problem is the fellows who use it.
It's precisely what Swami is saying here. Because Swami says, people do not become wise by mere education. Because an evil person, if educated, will become an evil educated person.
That is why one fellow in America said about his university, we produce clever devils.
Mm. In a way, he says the solution to this problem is samskriti or refinement. He says samskriti, he brings about samskriti, and he says it's the process of refinement. He gives many examples in the discourse. He says how paddy is refined to rice and a wrist watch made out of a lump of stainless steel. How because of refinement it becomes something usable and how cotton becomes cloth. In terms of human life and human approach, what is the samskriti that we have to go through, sir? What is the refinement that we have to go through?
That is simple. See, first of all you have to ask, what is it that gets impure? Mm-hmm. Before you say, how I purify it.
Okay.
The thing that really gets impure in us, which is the starting point of all the problem, is the mind.
Mm-hmm.
So, you have to refine the mind. And that process of purification is sadhana. Basically, sadhana is getting rid of the impurities in the mind. And Swami used to refer to these impurities as maliniyam, contamination.
Correct.
So, if you take, for example, iron ore, most of the iron ore is in the form of ferrites, complex ferrites, all kinds of ferrites. But I want iron. So, I have to first mine it, remove the mud, get all the various complexes of iron, they are all mostly salts, grind it and all that, and then heat it and melt it, and then iron will come out. But even that is not good iron. That is cast iron. It will be very spongy and all that. Then you have to process it further to make steel. And then you make special steel. You make magnetic steel, you make a non-magnetic steel. Then you make a highly non-porous steel of a very special kind that is needed for ultra-high vacuum and so on. You make special steel called maragin steel, which is used for high-strength applications. They are used in rockets to bind the... You see the PSLV, there are a lot of small rockets that are attached to the big rocket.
Correct.
The big ring that is used is made of what is called maragin steel. That's a very special kind of steel. So, there is a special kind of steel meant for swords. Therefore, you get all kinds of steels. And all that comes by taking the good old cast iron and processing it enormously. So, analogously, the mind must be cleansed and processed and refined. When you refine, you get samskriti. But the process of refinement is sadhana. There are many ways of doing that sadhana. But at the end of the day, it is refinement. And Swami used to say, I am like a goldsmith who puts the gold, then beats it, then deforms it, and then files it and polishes it. Ultimately, you get a jewel. So, maliniyam is infection of the mind, and removal is sadhana, and result is samskriti.
Samskriti. Very beautiful. I think with that topic, Swami comes to the end of the first discourse, in which, of course, he concludes saying that the Vice Chancellor has prayed that I should explain the significance of the body, senses, mind, intellect and Atma. And in response to his prayer, Swami gives the next set of 15 discourses.
1990, that must have been Dr. Sharaf.
Dr. Sharaf. He says, of what avail is it for one to know all about the external world without knowing about one's own reality? It's important for you to understand the nature of Brahman, the Atma. This is the royal path for the fulfillment of human life. Having said that, in the second discourse, Swami starts with what is absolutely the grossest form of existence, in the sense, you know, the human body. So he takes the first topic of the human body, and he starts by saying, you are not this body. You are not this bundle of flesh, blood and bones. Neither are you the unmanifested desires or the manifested mind. You are also not the delusion that thwarts your liberation, but you are the eternal Paramatma, if only you recognize your innate power. So, having said that, that is the first poem in which Swami introduces the discourse. Then Swami gives various definitions of the human body.
Right. And through those names, Swami explains why that this human body is impermanent and why you should not identify with it. And Swami says, Deha, it's called Deha. And Swami says,
Dahyate iti Deha, because that which burns.
And Sharira means one that decays.
Shiryate iti Sharira, one which decays. Then Mandir, he says, that which enshrines the Atma or God within. And Kshetra, which is...
the field.
Field.
Field and also a... pilgrim center.
Pilgrimage center.
Holy place.
Sacred place. And these are the various definitions for the human body. But before actually going into that, as we were referring to truth, Swami says why we need to understand these concepts. Because only when you understand the importance of these instruments given to you, will you be able to use them in the correct way. And he gives a very beautiful example. He says, if you do not know how to wear the shirt or banyan and a coat First you wear the banyan, then you wear the shirt, and then you wear the coat. If you do not know the importance and the functionality of each of them, you may wear them in the reverse order. You may wear the coat first and then the banyan on top of that. He says, in order to know how to utilize these instruments given to you, you should know about them. So that's how he starts the discourse.
That's absolutely vital in a surgical theater.
Mm-hmm.
There are large number of knives and scissors that are placed at the disposal of the surgeon.
Correct.
And they are kept in an order.
Mm-hmm.
Because he knows the procedure, he will need what.
Mm-hmm.
And then he will just be looking at the open portion of the body and put out his left hand if he's a right-hander. And just mention the name, the head chief nurse will hand it to him because one by one, mm-hmm. he will use it, put it here on the mm-hmm. right table. And in the end, actually they have to count.
Okay.
Also
okay.
the bandages, make sure nothing is left inside because when they open, they often, it happens.
Right, it happens.
Fellow comes out in the hospital, something is there, they go do an x-ray, one scissors is left behind.
Mm-hmm.
So they are supposed to count it also. Mm-hmm. So the purpose for which it is intended must be known. It's very, very important in engineering and in medicine because you must use the right tool for the right job.
Then in a natural flow from the various definitions of the human body, Swami goes on to say two aspects of how to sanctify the body, how to utilize it correctly. And one is ahara and another is vihara. He is giving a lot of importance to the kind of food that you partake. Obviously, it strengthens your body. And vihara, that is habits and behavior. Talking of ahara, he says sattvic ahara is what we should take
right. in. And of course, before that, Swami makes a very important point. He says food is not just what you intake through your mouth.
Yes.
Before,
no, that is because food is also at the senses.
Right, all that which goes through.
But regarding the food, mm-hmm. sattvic, mm-hmm. it's very interesting. Just yesterday I was listening to a radio program,
mm-hmm.
American radio program, where they were discussing and its relationship to the kind of bacteria
mm-hmm.
that it supports in the gut. And the impact these bacteria have on the brain.
Oh.
And this is the interesting thing. So, there is a doctor who is studying people, volunteers.
Mm-hmm.
He gives them yogurt and then does functional MRI. Mm-hmm. Now, in India, we consider yogurt as a good thing. Because it has bacteria that is promotes digestion.
Mm-hmm.
And apparently, you can give a person a food which will support a kind of bacteria which can create a certain kind of hard wiring of the brain. And that may be either positive or negative.
Mm-hmm.
So, what Ayurveda talks in terms of sattvic food,
mm-hmm.
modern medicine is now trying to find through volunteers, functional MRI and so on and so forth.
True.
But they knew it intuitively. This mm-hmm. kind of food is rajasic food, this kind of food is tamasic food, this mm-hmm. kind of food is sattvic food.
Correct.
And, but we are trying to find it a very hard way, spending a lot of money.
That's true.
I think they might have been in a very clear state of mind where they might have eaten this food and immediately they could have recognized the kind of thoughts which would have arisen, which is quite difficult for us with all that is running in our mind.
It is also the result of what you call practices of the Maharishis.
Mm-hmm.
Maharishis were very focused.
Mm-hmm.
They wanted to do tapas and attain moksha or whatever it is.
Mm-hmm.
And they had must have experimented what kind of food was best for them in order right. to promote concentration, in order to remain without food for a long time,
mm-hmm.
in order to create the right mental attitudes, because all those were important. And that knowledge must have been passed down the ages. And if you actually read the Gita, there are many chapters where Krishna devotes entirely to gunas.
Correct.
And he also talks about the kind of food mm-hmm. and the kind of gunas that result thereof.
Mm-hmm.
So this is ancient knowledge. I'm sure it has come through experience and also trial and error.
Correct. In this context, Swami says that, of course, as we mentioned, that food is not only what we take through the mouth. It's also through the various senses.
That is because they attach a lot of importance to senses.
Mm-hmm.
You see, we take the senses for granted, and mainly as, you know, we have this thing in computer called I/O devices, mm-hmm. input-output devices. Mm-hmm. Most of the senses are input devices. Okay. So we take them for granted. But in the case of this people on the spiritual path, they paid a lot of attention to input devices, because what the senses input ultimately goes to the mind and remains there as information and impressions. So they wanted to make sure that the wrong kind of things don't go through the senses.
Correct.
So what goes to the senses was considered as food for the mind. Mm. And therefore, it's not only the food for the body that must be pure and appropriate. The food for the mind also must be good and appropriate. In modern life, in science and in Western philosophy, that is totally kept out.
Okay.
It's totally kept out. It's considered irrelevant. But no, the sense and mind control was given a lot of importance. That's why whenever Swami used to talk about sense and mind control, in my shorthand notes I would write MSC. It's very easy to remember that, MSC. I had abbreviations, TKS, Trikarna Suddhi. So as he speaks, you know, you can't go on writing everything. MSC, TKS, I had a lot of code words like that. The Trikarna Suddhi is again another very important concept, the harmony of thought, word and action.
Here when he says, for example, when he says sanctify the vision that is given to you, the sense of sight, see what is good, don't see what is evil. Hear what is good, don't hear what is evil. Now, when Swami says this statement, oftentimes we are left wondering what is good and what is evil. When you say, see what is good, don't see what is evil, how do we define what is good and what is evil?
That's a good question. See, when you are a yogi, there is neither good nor evil. I am neutral. Mm-hmm. But when I am not neutral, it is like having pH plus or minus,
okay,
positive or negative. And this applies only to those kind of people. If I take food, I call rubbish. If I give it to a pig, it eats it, nothing happens to it. It's conditioned differently.
Mm-hmm.
But if I eat old food, there are bacteria in it, which will harm me.
Mm-hmm.
Let's say there is fungus in it. My system cannot tolerate it. So I will get into problems.
Mm-hmm.
Similarly, see no evil means, if I see certain things, then what happens to what I see? It just goes to my mind. And my mind goes off on tracks which are not good for me.
Okay.
It will take me away from God. Basically, mm-hmm. good and bad is, I have to follow a route.
Mm-hmm.
And my route is towards God. If I deviate from that route, I am not going towards God. If you want to go to hell, that's all right.
Correct.
But God doesn't want you to go to hell. So mm-hmm. he says, you have a GPS system which tells you I made a wrong turn. Go to the right turn. Basically, good and God are defined in relation to my journey to God. If it takes me away from God, it is bad. If it takes me towards God, it is good. It's as simple as that. That is the simplest way of, if I abolish God, then there is nothing good, there is nothing bad. Then what is good is what is good for my senses.
You are just saying that it's not relevant for yogis, but how is that, sir? For what state is a yogi in?
Yogi in the state of samatvam. Okay. He is in the world of God, which
all
is everything is same. There is only oneness. There is no good, there is no bad, there is only God.
Mm.
If I have reached that state, that's very difficult.
Correct.
Then there is no good or bad. But supposing I have not reached that stage, still I can look at it in the following way. The action of that person is not good, but the person is not bad.
Okay. Mm.
Gandhi used to say, I have no quarrel with the Britisher. I have only quarreled with the Britisher imposing his system on me. So, I don't see you as an evil person. I see the Atma in you. But the outside is not functioning properly. That is different from you.
Mm.
I don't associate the actions with the inside normally. I associate with outside and I say he's a bad fellow. The yogi will say he's not an evil man.
Mm.
He's a good man,
mm-hmm.
but his actions are bad. So he doesn't pass any judgment on the person. That is why Ravana, when he dies,
mm-hmm.
Rama goes to Vibhishana and says, he had to be punished. That is different.
Mm. Mm.
You can't now associate all that with the dead body. You have a duty, he's an elder brother. Either you cremate him or I cremate him.
Mm.
You have to give that respect.
Mm.
And similarly, when Vali dies, Rama summons Lakshmana and says, he was a king. Mm. Make sure the last rites are performed like a king.
Mm.
He gives that instruction. It's there in Valmiki.
Mm.
So they bring a palanquin and they take him and all that. They all go to Tungabhadra and do snanam there, including Lord Rama.
Mm. In fact, logically speaking, that's the next point in the discourse where he says vihara, that is behavior. And Swami says ahara is important, equally important is vihara,
absolutely.
Behavior. And he says that, he goes on to explain how company, tell me your company, I should tell you what you are, that influences your vihara and behavior to a large extent. These two points, ahara and vihara, he says, if it's kept in mind, then you can utilize the body in a proper way.
And 3 points that Swami says about vihara is mind the places where you are in, the company which you keep, and the habits which you develop.
Mm-hmm.
That's what vihara is all about. Then, so this question would often come, you know, when you say that you keep good company, you keep with people who are good. And people will say, how do you transform them? If the good is always with the good, how does the evil get transformed?
You first have to be tough to make sure that infection doesn't affect you. For example, at the time of the tsunami in 2004, mm-hmm. Sevadals had to go and remove all the corpses. The others were not allowed to touch. Many of them didn't want to because the bodies were decaying. So, in fact, I've got a photograph where a lady doctor is giving anti-tetanus injection to the Sevadals. So before you handle that, you have to make sure you take the protection. So before you start dealing with that evil guys, you must make sure when you go and meet them, you don't become evil yourself. Mm. If you are not conditioned, then you are not fit for the job. So you have to protect yourself first properly.
Mm.
That's what it means. Till you are not ready, you should not go and deal with the real tough guys. That doesn't mean you can't deal with elementary cases. For example, medical students, they often are in the operation theater when the surgeon does the surgery. They will do small jobs depending on the situation. For example, in the end, the surgeon will say, this is how I stitch. He will show three stitches and say, do a little bit. Then before that, he will say, this is how I bandage. Do it. Then this is how I remove the bandage. Do it. This is how I clean the wound. Do it. So, step by step, you have to come graduate into tougher and tougher jobs. But on day one, you don't go and deal with the most evil person on earth.
Being good for a day doesn't...
Then Swami says there are 3 misconceptions that we are faced with when identification with the body. He says wrong identification with the body and mind. He says we regard objects and people as belonging to us. We say this is mine, this is his. And believing the temporary to be eternal. He says these are the 3 misconceptions. And more or less that's how he ends the second discourse where he deals with body. The third discourse is also an extension on the same theme. The title is Moving Temple. Now, I think here he brings out various points. He says, yes, the body is temporary, but it has to be taken care of because it houses the Atman, because the Atman is inside. And he says, just as the diamond, even if it is put in garbage, it does not lose its innate value, nor does the pumpkin that is growing on a thorny fence. It does not lose its taste. So also, the Atman is not defiled by the body. the Atman remains eternal and unchanged. And here is an important point. He says, when importance is given only to the body, then it's such a civilization even collapses. He gives the example of Roman civilization. And he says how undue importance was given only to the body. And he says because of which the civilization came down. Sir, just looking at history and looking at various civilizations, do you think there is a pattern of evolution on how people are looking at various, like the Romans looked at the body and the Indian civilization which has stood the test of time because it's looking deeper into the subtler aspects? Do you have any comments on that?
See, you have to be careful how you use the word civilization. Normally, mm-hmm. the term civilization is used associated with a period of history
okay.
where one empire or group of emperors
mm-hmm.
built up an edifice of knowledge, a structure of society with a lot of achievements.
Correct.
So, Egyptian civilization, it's symbolized by the pyramids and things like that. So, Roman civilization, it had certain characteristics. Greek civilization, for a while, it celebrated knowledge. There was also architecture mm-hmm. and drama, poets and so on and so forth. Whereas, when we talk of Indian, there were many civilizations, the Mauryan empire and mm-hmm. so on and so forth. But there is a thing called Indian tradition.
Mm-hmm.
That has remained unchanged for the longest period in history. There is no other tradition that one can speak of that has had such a long innings on such a large scale, at least not to my knowledge. I don't think there is anything else.
Mm.
Even today, we have things like Upanayanam and so on, which is based on the traditions of thousands of years, and the underlying principle is also the same.
Hmm.
Upanayanam, Brahmopadesam, Gayatri Mantram, it has been there from Vishwamitra's days to the present day. That kind of continuity and constancy, I don't think exists in other, what you call, cultures. But if you talk of civilization, you have the Indus Valley civilization, the Arapa civilization, so on. They are different. But if you talk in terms of culture, Sanskriti, Bharatiya Sanskriti, as some used to say, that is very unique. I mean, essence of Bharatiya Sanskriti is true knowledge is valued.
Correct.
Vidya, and that must go along with Vinayam.
Hmm.
That must manifest as Dharma, and so on. Those values survive longest in our culture.
In fact, that's what Swami says. He says self-knowledge or knowledge of the Atman, which was given a lot of importance in our Indian tradition. He says, when you have that self-knowledge, you become a drashta, a seer. You actually start seeing, you become a drashta. And a very beautiful and powerful statement, he says, the ultimate aim of bhakti is to become such a drashta and to experience the world with its spiritual perspective as background. Then he defines manava. He says, you are not new. You are ancient.
Manava.
He says. And then he says, our life can be compared to a limited company. Now, this is a very interesting topic. I don't know whether we have the time. Do we have time?
Yeah, I think we'll have about 10 minutes.
Oh, that's good. Because Swami says, limited company, this body can be taken as a limited company in which everything has to be within limits. Take the blood pressure, take the heartbeat, everything has to be within limits. And he says, unless if on the moment you have the limit is crossed, there is danger.
That is a very important point. In fact, I gave a talk in Delhi some weeks ago on growth, stability and order in human society, and I was drawing examples from nature. And today, what is happening is, we are talking a lot about growth.
Correct.
Growth has slowed down.
Mm-hmm.
What is this growth? Growth is mainly GDP growth, gross domestic product, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. and some other parameters related to that.
Mm-hmm.
Money flow and all that.
Correct.
you can't have too much of it. You can't have endless consumption, more of consumerism and all that. If you have too much of that, that society will collapse. So therefore, there is a limit.
Even limit to the, in the society?
There is a natural limit.
Correct, correct.
And people are not appreciating that. It's a law of nature. There's always a contest between growth and stability. And in nature, if you see, to achieve stability, at some point it stops growing. It stops growing.
Correct.
That is always the case. Mm-hmm. There's a very interesting study which Eddington did on stars. He just said, what is a star? Star is a glass, gas globule. So he said, let me consider a star, gas globules of various sizes. 10 to the power of 1 gram, 10 to the power of 2 grams, 10 to the power of 40 grams, 10 to the power of 70 grams. Mm-hmm. I mean, then it goes into huge size.
Mm-hmm.
So, when you take big gas globules, they will start shrinking because of gravity. So that will start heating. So the heat will then try to expand. So then he found that of all these gas globules, only gas globules in a certain range are stable. Otherwise, they are torn apart either because of radiation pressure or gas pressure. Contest between radiation pressure and gas pressure.
Okay.
It's like a marriage. Mm-hmm. In the marriage where both are sort of equally strong, it holds. Otherwise, one dominates and that thing comes apart. So there is a stable size of, that's why it is found that no star in the universe is more than 100 times the mass of the sun. Mm-hmm. Or less than 3/4 of the mass of the sun. Mass of the sun is, our sun is taken as a unit.
Oh,
it's in a range. Similarly, you don't have any human being with you who is 10,000 pounds.
Correct.
Can't be.
Mm.
Person will die.
Mm.
I mean, you have people, King Kong and other 600, but those are exceptional cases. There's a normal weight for the body.
Mm.
And if it is too small, then also it will die, it will collapse, it because there is not enough energy to sustain the system and all that. Mm-hmm. So in nature, things grow only up to a point. You take a tree, beyond that point it will not grow because it cannot supply nutrition, there will be all sorts of problems.
Mm. Even in the body or in the society, if the limits are crossed, there is danger. And in fact, that's how he leads to the next point, which says ceiling on desires. He says, don't waste energy, don't waste time, don't waste money, don't waste energy. So these are the things that Swami has
and
been
telling. Today, the seeds for destruction are being sown by saying desire should have no ceiling. Essentially asking you to consume, go to shopping mall, buy, buy, buy. So Christmas is supposed to be January 25th. Christmas shopping season now starts in September. Why? Because they want to sell. They are all the time selling. And they are asking you to buy. Do you have that much of money? No, you don't. Then how do you buy? Oh, yes, that's a thing called credit card. You go on buying on the credit card.
Mm.
And if a million people buy on credit card and they are not able to pay, then the company will collapse, which has given the loans. The shopping malls will then collapse because there will be nobody to buy. So we just cannot go on doing this sort of thing, but foolishly, we are trying to do that. And now they are facing their problems in many countries in China. They have built a lot of cities, they are empty, thinking there is going to be a boom. Entire cities are empty. And when the money dries up, the shopping malls become empty.
Mm.
So they put on the lights, everybody sitting there, there is nobody to do any buying. In fact, last year when I went to New Zealand, on days when it was raining, they would take me for a walk in the shopping malls because it doesn't rain. Park the car for 2 hours, so I'd go. Because I was very safe. I didn't have a credit card, I didn't have a wallet. So, but then I saw in many shops, the shopkeepers are playing video games with their cell phones because there are no buyers.
That's true.
People are just going here and there in coffee shops, the people drink. There's no money to buy. Shops are full of things. Nobody buys. You have a slump.
Mm.
So you can't go on sustaining that forever. You eat. How much can you eat? At some point you say, enough, enough, enough.
That's a beautiful point that Swami says. Ceiling on desire should be based on discriminative knowledge.
Absolutely.
Not just as a theory which you accept, but that comes out of discriminative knowledge.
The fundamental point is, desire is associated with a path that takes you away from God. So, I put a ceiling on desires, not because I don't have money to buy or anything like that. I want to ask myself the question, what am I here for? Life must be a journey to God. What is the greatest obstacle? Desire. So, the more I get rid of desire, the easier it becomes for me to steer toward God. So, steering wheel must be turned in the opposite direction so that my car goes in the right direction. Correct. That is the main reason. That should be the basic reason. Of course, preserving the economy and the ecology, ecosystem, planet and all that is necessary, but those are secondary conditions. Automatically, if I start saying, my job is to go towards God, I don't want to be distracted, half the problems on earth will disappear, just like that. No money is needed. Only willpower is needed.
Correct. In fact, Swami says, the one who seeks the Atma is a gopi, the other one is a papi.
That's very good.
In fact, another beautiful point which Swami makes is, there is no difference between the sun and its rays. There is no difference between the sea and its waves. Likewise, there is no difference between God and love. In the sense, Swami is saying that whether you do ceiling on desires or discriminative knowledge for the society or for God, it's the same. It's not that.
That is because society is God.
Because society is God.
But we don't realize that. We think society has to be exploited. And Mrs. Thatcher famously said there is no such thing as society, because basically she was focusing too much on the individuals. Individuals are a part of society. You can't just have atoms. You must have a solid. Because only then you can make things out of the solid. What can you do with a single atom? Precious little.
So, bringing these points, Swami then says how food, head and God are interrelated. I think we have covered that point when we spoke about sattvic food and how they influence even the mind and the thoughts. Swami concludes this discourse by asking the question, what is meditation? You say you are sanctifying your time with meditation, but if you are sitting in meditation and your mind is in the bazaar, in the mall possibly, that is not meditation. So he says, so instead of doing that kind of meditation, it's better you go to the society and serve. He says, spend your, in fact, when we were discussing this, we were wondering how to sanctify time. And here is an answer. He says, if you are really not able to concentrate and do meditation, sanctify your time with service. Go to the society and do service. And then he says, first of all, try to understand the nature of the mind. Then only you will be able to control it.
Actually, long ago, one man came and tried to force me to do meditation, this and that. You know, if you want to do meditation, you must start at the age of 4 or 5. And he was trying to do it to me at the age of 60. Then I was practical. And he said, I shook him off. And he said, you engage in God's work and do it properly in the spirit of a karma yogi. That is meditation. And Vivekananda puts it very nicely. He says, meditation is constant remembrance of God. And some of the best meditation used to be done by the women of olden times. And I have seen them with my own eyes. They would get up, have bath. They won't have much time to do puja and all that. That is done by the men folk. And while they are cooking, they will be chanting Lalita Sahasranamam and things like that. And do the cooking. So, that is real meditation. Constant remembrance of God. And there is nothing better than that. So, in fact, it is quite easy. If you just sit there and try to say, chant Lalita Sahasranam, mind will go here and there. But when you are cooking, you know, automatically you have to make sure this is done, that is done, you have to bring water, you have to grind something into a paste and all that, so you are focused. So that drill goes on in the background. And simultaneously, as Shruti, Lalita Sahasranamam goes. That is one of the best things. I've seen my mother do all those things. And that was an excellent tradition. That is meditation.
Correct.
That's what Krishna tells Arjuna. He says, do Anusmarana even as you fight in the battle. That's the command he gives.
I guess that is very relevant to gents of today. When they go to stock market or when they go to their offices, they are literally fighting a battle and they have to think.
Decent fellow won't go to the stock market.
If you exercise your discriminative knowledge, you might not end up there.
Why should I go to stock market and then say Ram 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 Ram? What is happening? BP will go up, stock is going down, value is going down, BP will go up.
I think that concludes the segment on the body. So we have covered three discourses today, and that concludes the segment where Swami is bringing out details about and how to control and sanctify the body. The next segment is on the senses. So
the wonderful way with which Swami concludes the discourse, he says everything that God has created has a purpose. Nothing is meaningless. So you endeavor to understand what is the meaning behind each
aspect
of this.
What is astonishing is there is so much of what you call knowledge and wisdom packed in Swami's discourses. The density of wisdom is enormous.
Correct.
People give talks. Most of it is empty, hollow nonsense. And people have study circles, they discuss discourses. Mostly it is tending to understand one sentence line by line. That is of no use. Unless you take it in relation to life, society, and what is happening to us today, it is of no use. But the moment you do that, suddenly, these discourses become enormously profound. Now, as I was listening to you go through the various points Swami was making, I found it was immensely expansive because my mind was racing. Oh, it means this, it means that, that. So, I stand in awe, absolute awe, that he was with us and he said all these things, and most of the time people were sleeping. Towards the end, you know, there came a time when I have seen people playing with their iPhones when Swami was giving discourses. And as he used to say, that is their prapti. There he was talking about very subtle and profound things. And people were playing with their iPhones. So they were, I won't call them papis, but I will definitely say they were not gopis. It's not for me to say they are papis. Yes, they're sad, they missed it. And they, you see, when you sit back and listen and reflect, how much of what you call profundity and depth is there.
Very true. In fact, it is, as you mentioned repeatedly, the summary and the most important portions of all the Upanishads and scriptures. It is a, you know, he gives it in a nutshell, essence of all that.
And yet, he makes it so expansive as to be applicable to everything. That's why I often say he took the 700 slokas of the Gita and packaged it into 700 discourses.
Correct. Very true.
Applicable to different people.
In fact, in 12th chapter, as he says, Yome Bhakta Samay Priyaha. He says, he is dear to me, he is dear to me. In a way, Swami, without our knowledge, made us do that. He made us do activities, made us do things to please him in the physical realm. But on deeper reflection, it is actually to please the God within. Otherwise, where would you have people sitting for an hour and 2 hours just waiting for him in darshan or reading spiritual literature? It's something very rare.
In fact, he said, if you go to a temple, you have to stand in a queue to go to the deity. Here, I come to you. I bend down and take your letter. I bend down and listen to what you say. You don't have to get up and talk to me. I bend down. Where does it happen? It doesn't happen anywhere.
Descent of God for the ascent of man.
That's
the problem
true.
Is man is not even trying to ascend.
So, thank you, sir. Thank you on behalf of all the listeners for joining us on the summary, because it's definitely a wonderful exercise to go back and revisit these discourses. Though we have gone through them over several weeks, it definitely even warrants another relook as our personal sadhana. I hope all listeners also do that. And so on behalf of all of us here, Sai Prakash and Venkatraman sir, I offer this humble effort of ours at Bhagwan's lotus feet. We conclude with a prayer that next week too we will be able to continue the summary, and we also place a request in front of sir that he be a part of the program next week too. Thank you, sir, and thank you, dear listeners, for joining us. Sai Ram.
Sai Ram, you just heard an episode of our radio series Shravanam Mananam Nididhyasanam, that is, Listen, Reflect and Absorb. This is a segment that is hosted live on Thursdays at 7:30 p.m. by Team Radio Sai's Sai Prakash and Prem only on Asia Stream of Radio Sai Global Harmony. In today's episode, which was first broadcast live on 21st November 2013, Professor Jeevankatraman, former Vice Chancellor of the Sri Satya Sai Institute of Higher Learning and the senior-most member of Team Radio Sai, participated as a guest. The divine discourses undertaken for study in this program are from the series of discourses delivered as part of the summer course in Indian culture and spirituality in the year 1990. And to listen to the next part of this program, please tune in same time next week and do write to us and do let us know what you think about this program by writing to listener@radiosai.org. Thank you and Sai Ram from Prashanti Nilayam.